I probably don't need to introduce ChatGPT. It's been a huge disruption to so many different industries, fascinating and scaring people alike. But in case you have been living under a rock, what text-generating AI like ChatGPT do is kind of on the tin. They take a written prompt from a user and then generate a written response. And most of the time, it's a coherent response, as opposed to just being a bunch of letters like... If you look at what these algorithms are doing, they're effectively trying to predict what words should come next, after the user's prompt, based on their own knowledge scraped from the internet. It's kind of a bit like autocorrect on steroids. Really powerful steroids, though. It's reasonable to feel excited about where the tech is going, but it's also reasonable to feel a bit cynical. I mean, just in the past couple of weeks, Elon Musk announced that he's going to make a competitor to ChatGPT, despite being a co-founder of the very company that made ChatGPT. The source code for Facebook's own text-generating AI, Llama, just leaked online, and even Snapchat has jumped on the craze. So it's easy to look at all of that and say, okay, that's cool, but are chatbots and images the only thing that generative AI has to offer for humanity? Well, the answer is no. There is so much that generative AI has to offer, like designer drugs or proteins that can digest plastic, and even these proteins, which do nothing but take on the shape of Latin letters. And I'm gonna tell you why there's already an awesome body of research around all of this stuff. But first, in order for me to actually do that, we need to do a little refresher just to get everyone caught up to speed. Now, if you ask any first year biochemist to list all of the amino acids for you, they'll be like, oh yeah, I'll definitely know them. Just ask me in like a year's time, I'll yeah, 100%. No, no, was that just me? Okay. Anyway, they'll hopefully at least be able to tell you that there's 20 common amino acids, each of which we can represent in short form with a different letter of the Latin alphabet. A for alanine, V for valine, R for arginine, Y for tyrosine. What idiot picked the Anyway, just like English, if we put those letters together in the right order, then we can make up something useful. Not a word in this case, but a functional protein made of amino acids. And also, just like English, you can just mash a bunch of letters together and make gibberish instead. Like kablululu. And no one wants a kablululu protein floating around their body, because it'll contribute no function, it'll look ugly, and it'll just be toxic, and no one wants that around. Now, proteins carry out most of the biological functions necessary for life. So if we can learn the language of how DNA instructs cells to make proteins, then just like how a computer programmer can write code for computers, then we could copy bits of, or even make new DNA from scratch to do new things, like grow meat in a lab, make new crops that need less water, or even make bacteria that can digest plastic. But inventing and perfecting proteins is an extremely complicated task, one that continues to take evolution millions to billions of years to do. One huge problem for DNA programmers is that DNA code combinations are endless, and in the past, we had to do everything by hand, which made programming cells a very slow process. If you wanted to make a new protein just by copying bits and putting them together, you would have to spend weeks, usually months, and at the end of that, you may or may not even have a cell that can keep itself alive, yet alone do what you wanted it to do. That was a huge limiter in this field of biotech. Our tools were, well, they just weren't very good. So let's wrap around now back to the beginning. ChatGPT can do anything from writing draft scripts for channels like ours, to creating screenplays, to even passing law school exams. One of its most impressive features, though, in my opinion, is being able to write bits of code and put together novel computer programs. Fully functioning, useful computer programs. Now, you might see where I'm going with this. If it understands languages like Python or JavaScript, can it decode the language of DNA, amino acids, proteins? Can text-generative AI make novel, useful proteins? The answer? No, it cannot. And believe me, I tried. 3 different times, actually. The first time I asked it to make me a protein that could bind plastic, and yeah, that was way too ambitious. Just turned out as something that would be a blob if you grew it in a cell. A Cthulhu, if you will. The most recent time, I did it with Bing GPT, which is ChatGPT, but with internet access. So I was able to give it a recent paper to read on the topic. Afterwards, I then asked it to make me just a simple, non-functional protein, just with the general shape of the letter A. And in its defense, it didn't believe in itself the first few times around, and I had to massage the prompt to actually get it to work. And when it did work, yeah, it was right to not believe in itself. What you're looking at here is a simulated structure of the Bing GPT protein that I made using AlphaFold 2. And while it does bear some resemblance to the letter A, that's probably more coincidence than anything. If you look at the color of it and then compare it to the key, you can see that it corresponds to a pretty low model confidence overall. Generally speaking, if a protein has low model confidence, it tends to be pretty floppy. And if I want a protein to take on a specific shape, such as the letter that A, floppiness is the opposite of what I want. And yeah, this protein seems to be a wobbly, insecure mess.
But why, then? If ChatGPT can learn JavaScript by looking at people's programs on the internet, why can't it learn the language of amino acids by looking at complete functional proteins from the protein databank? And what, then, are these protein structures that do look like letters of the alphabet? Who or what made those? Okay, so ChatGPT may have failed, but it wasn't tuned for protein design. Earlier, I was using the language analogy to explain amino acids, but that analogy kind of starts to break down a little bit here. Putting together a protein isn't as simple as putting together a sentence, so of course ChatGPT struggles. For one thing, the order of letters isn't the only important thing. The context of every single amino acid can affect the 3D structure. It would be as if adding a wrong letter didn't just mess up the meaning of the word that it's a part of, but the whole sentence, the rest of the paragraph before and after it, the whole story falls apart because you put one wrong letter there. But AI tools have actually been extremely successful in the field of biology and biotech, but only when purpose-built with biology in mind. AlphaFold 2, which I just mentioned for instance, is an AI system that predicts a protein's 3D structure from an amino acid sequence. And AlphaFold 2 incredible accuracy was only made possible by its machine learning. And its accuracy is incredible, take my word for it. When I was in first year, I was told structural predictions wouldn't be that accurate within my lifetime. Now I've got them running on a computer. And not even that, I can just run it on a Google document online for free. Now, the fun part is that by doing a few tweaks and flipping the direction of software like AlphaFold 2, you can actually make it give you the amino acid sequence for a desired protein structure. Okay. So what? So everything! We have struggled along for years to make new proteins. It takes months to figure out if it'll even work. And that was just by sticking together other parts, not generating them from scratch. Evolution still takes millions of years to evolve a useful protein. Reversing AlphaFold lets us start much further along that process by doing most of the legwork for us. This might sound niche, but AI-enhanced protein design is very quickly becoming huge business. On the 26th of January, Profluent reported that they had received $9 million in seed funding for their project on using machine learning to engineer new proteins. In March of 2022, Arzeda received $33 million to support their ongoing protein design programs. And just a few months before that, Generate Biomedicines signed a drug development deal that could be worth more than $1.9 billion in total. So what are all these companies working on then? And why is it worth so much money? Well, a recent preprint from Generate Biomedicines can probably shed some light on the matter. In it, they detail a new algorithm that they call Chroma, which they describe as a generative model for proteins and protein complexes. It's based on a diffusion model, which is an approach used in lots of image generation tools like DALL-E, and is something that makes it easier to manipulate complex and multi-dimensional data. The Generate team demonstrate that Chroma can make proteins that obey a variety of constraints given by the user, including symmetries, substructure, shape, and even text descriptions. Now, I say demonstrate in quotes because even though the amino acid sequences are gives seem to fold into the correct shape when you plug them into something like AlphaFold, they haven't been proven yet. As user AHF95 was quick to point out on Reddit, even though Generate Biomedicine cite a lot of different computational metrics in their preprint, their reported structures are all just hypothetical, with no actual experimental real-world validation. Without having tested their designs, Chroma's protein structures are just a simulation, with no way of testing if they've actually got their desired end property. They only exist as structures on a computer. We have no idea how good Chroma is at its job, and we won't unless they publish some figures for us to look at. So does that mean that protein diffusion is just a promise for now and may prove to be a dud? No! Days before the Generate Biomedicines preprint was published, another lab, run by well-known synthetic biologist David Baker, published their own preprint. In their paper, they described their own protein diffusion-based software, which they designed using their own in-house alternative to AlphaFold, which they call RosettaFold. So the protein diffusion software is then called RosettaFold Diffusion, or RFDiffusion for short. However, unlike Generate Biomedicines and their software Chroma, the Baker Lab actually uses a multi-step process for designing their proteins. So it can come across a little bit convoluted, so you're gonna have to stick with me here. The first step is to plug the desired end structure into RF diffusion and get an initial protein shape in the way of a 3D structure that hopefully fits what you asked for. That 3D protein structure is then put through something called relaxation before it's then run through yet another software, Protein MPNN. Protein MPNN, which is another platform also published by the David Baker lab, then designs the final amino acid sequence that fits the relaxed 3D protein structure. In any case, the end result is something similar to chroma. You put in some constraints, and you get a selection of amino acid sequences out of the end of it that should fit your design. They even ran some computational analysis to validate their software, like Generate did with chroma. The difference, then, is that the Baker Lab has actually grown their proteins and bacteria to validate them and publish the findings. Extensive findings. They tested hundreds of designs by examining them with a few different methods, the main one being electron microscopy. Validating in real life is actually really important because in-house wet lab facilities, i.e. the actual growing and testing of the proteins, are another critical component of the design process. Because aside from validating the 3D structure of these AI-generated proteins, experimental results can be, in turn, used to retrain algorithms to achieve even better outcomes in future rounds. So though chroma is exciting, we have yet to actually see if it can hold up to public scrutiny, whereas RFDiffusion represents a much more concrete leap forward. They also note that it's reminiscent in a way of artwork generation from text prompts, in that RFDiffusion makes it possible to generate proteins with pretty much minimal knowledge from the user, beyond them providing some very simple molecular specifications. Even with our limited tools of the past, researchers have been able to create all sorts of awesome protein applications. Take, for instance, the team led by James Collins, who were able to make wearable biosensors. Their flagship design for this was a face mask that can change colors when it detects COVID particles, which is so cool that we might even make a separate video just covering that paper. Now, until research teams get out there and test any of the stuff I'm about to say, this will all remain speculative, but there is a very strong potential for this massive leap forward in protein design to revolutionize what kinds of biomaterials and biosensors we can make. I mean, for one thing, we could make designer proteins that act as delivery containers into individual cells for drugs and medicines. Protein diffusion tools could generally revolutionize loads of different industries by creating super efficient biocatalysts for the splitting of water to make hydrogen biofuel, or the digestion of plastic, or turning solar energy into chemical energy like a plant can, and potentially doing multiple of these at the same time. On a shorter timescale, they could be used to design new therapeutics in the way of new classes of antibodies, enzymes, vaccines. The Baker Lab even thinks that as protein diffusion becomes more sophisticated, it could, in some cases, surpass what natural evolution can achieve. And again, it's important to acknowledge that most of what I said was speculative for now. But no matter what, protein diffusion has already given us a huge leap forward compared to previous techniques. But what do you think? Are we at the precipice of something huge with the AI sector in biotech? Will synthetic biology approaches coupled with protein diffusion set off a biotech revolution? Or is it just a load of empty promises said by some guy screaming at his camera? Let us know in the comments section or in the various other forums that we'll link in the description below. It's a fellow instead of below. Let us know in the comments section below or in the various other forum sections that we'll link in the description. Thanks for now, and goodbye. Finally, that's like the 9th time I filmed this because so many things went wrong. Fellow. Probably get demonetized for a little bit.